And this is the Bluetooth adapter that we're going to use to control the scope. It is made by Bolotech, and it is a BCO4 based device. I got this one from eBay for about $11 Canadian, and what it does is transpose Bluetooth signals into RS-232 commands through this DB9 port. And we will use the DB9 port with the scope with this device, which is called a DB9 breakout connector. The beauty of this is you can, using these screw terminals, you can put the wires wherever you want, and they're very clearly labeled as to receive, transmit, and ground. We're only going to use three of these ports though. That simplifies a lot. And as you can see, these are both female connectors, so you can get these breakout connectors in either male or female, so that's not a big deal, and they're not expensive. I got mine from a friend who had just happened to give it to me. But anyway, I decided to get a gender changer rather than ordering a new one, which allows us to connect it directly up with no problem at all. It just makes it a little bit longer. To get a better look at the RS-232 Bluetooth connector, you can see there's the Bluetooth transmitter and antenna there. Here is the switch that enables you to go from master to the center position, which is off, and to the slave position. We will be using it in slave mode, so we may as well switch it there now. This port is if you want to hook up a 5-volt battery, which I'm sure there are many options for that online. A small lithium ion that you could kind of build into a case. I'm going to be powering it through this USB port right here. And over here is the DB9 connector. And this is a reset button, which I've not had the pleasure of using yet. So to start with, I found an old telephone handset and I snipped a bit of wire from it so I can strip off three of the ends of the wire for screwing into the screw terminals of the DB9 connector, which will in turn hook up to the Bluetooth device. And this is the telescope mount we're going to be controlling, the iOptron SmartEQ Pro with the GoToNova 8408 controller. I'll lift that off its hanging post. And you'll see that the hand controller has an extra port on the bottom. This is a 4-pin port. It's narrower by quite a bit than the 6-pin port that normally comes with the phone. This is how narrow that is. It's the type of port that usually comes with a telephone handset. And what I've done is snip one off with the wires hanging, and that's what we'll attach to the DB9 breakout connector. And this will allow us to issue commands to the hand controller and in turn control the mount. Now the iOptron manual has a page in it where it outlines how to construct your own RS-232 to RJ9 cable. The RJ9 plug is the small plug on the bottom of the handset that receives RS-232 commands. It's basically a very narrow telephone handset type connector. It's got four wires coming from it. And what we're going to do is wire this according to the diagram in the iOptron manual, except for two of the wires being reversed. As you can see in the diagram, it mentions that RS-232 pin 2 should go to RJ9 pin 4, RS-232 pin 3 should go to RJ9 pin 3, and RS-232 pin 5 should go to RJ9 pin 1. What we're going to do to modify this arrangement to make it work with our mount is reverse RJ9 pins 4 and 3. So RJ9 pin 4 will then go to RS-232 pin 3, and RJ9 pin 3 will go to RS-232 pin 2. Pins 5 and 1 remain the same. On my particular handset cord that I snipped out, there were four wires, green, yellow, red, and black. Well, I discarded the green wire because we don't need it in this arrangement. But the red and the black, if I recall, are the transmit and receives, so they have to be reversed from what iOptron mentions in this case to work with this particular Bluetooth adapter. And here we have the full assembly of the RJ9 telephone jack, and you can see that I've kind of done some reinforcing of the wires there with some heat shrink tubing, and you can see also where it jacks into the DB9 breakout connector with the screw terminals, and that plugs into the gender changer, which then plugs into the Bluetooth adapter. And all of this will simply dangle off of the hand controller of the mount while it's operating, until I come up with a more elegant way of containing it and making it look a little better. Okay, now that I have reinforced the wiring leading to the breakout connector and plugged it into the Bluetooth adapter, we're going to go through the procedure of pairing it with an Android tablet. A Galaxy Tab 2 by Samsung is what I'm using. First of all, we'll go to Settings and select Bluetooth. And the item that you're looking for is BC04-B in my case. Who knows what it would be technically for everyone else, I'm not sure. Let me check my polarization here, see what's going on. Okay, that's better. We're going to select that, and it's going to attempt to pair. It's going to unable to pair. Look at that. That's because I forgot to put power to it. Let's do that. It needs to be plugged in and switched to slave. So when you first plug it in, it'll go into a... Nigel, what can I do for you? Okay. Nigel just wants attention. Anyway, it'll flash steady, and then we'll attempt to pair it again. And you just enter 1234 when it asks for the pin. And hit done. And OK. And it will successfully pair. You won't see any change in the flashing. Now we'll go back to the home screen and start up the astronomy application, SkySafari 4 Pro. And you'll be presented with the sky. We start out, in my case, looking north. And along the bottom, you'll see an item that says scope. We're going to touch on that. You'll see, after we hit scope, you'll see a active button that says connect. When we do that, it may take 10 or 20 seconds, but you'll see the flashing blue light on the adapter go steady blue. There we go. And the application will center up where it thinks the scope is. I have mine kind of pretend north right now. And we're going to select another star, in this case Kochab. And we're going to hit the Go To button, which is now active, and the scope should begin making its way over there. We can drag the rate over to its highest value if we like. And hit Go To. And you'll see the scope start to move. And it's tracking. Now we're going to go to one of these other stars, Alcade. If I can get it to sense that. And hit Go To. And it shows a reticle that tells you that it's on target. And we're going to make our way back to Polaris. And this is all being commanded wirelessly to the handset to issue the slew commands. The only other aspect I have to deal with is the power. I could just have a power pack sitting under the scope with a 5-volt output from like a USB adapter and power it that way. That way it would still be fairly self-contained, or you could get a lithium-ion battery that could power it through the 5-volt port on the device. Anyway, it seems to work so far. We can also slew manually. We'll go to speed 9 on the controller and just start moving in deck. And it will show the reticle move until I let go. I'll start moving in right ascension, and it just the reticle tracks right along in the program. So it's quite nifty. Now I'm going to disconnect the mount through the disconnect button. And you'll see the adapter start flashing again. So that's it for operation.